She has a lot of power, more than that with having a Twitter account or an Instagram account, to advance feminist causes.
She is now in a singular, unprecedented, really, position. And that gives her voice a power that is going to be really interesting to see.
The royal family represents white supremacy. She is marrying into white supremacy. I don't think any black people should be marrying into white supremacy.
Se há dúvidas quanto à sobrevivência da ativista ou feminista na pele de princesa, o que ninguém questiona é a crescente popularidade de Meghan Markle desde o noivado. O novo casamento real virou uma verdadeira obsessão.
Something that people are really excited by and obsessed. And I tell you that as somebody, I'm obsessed with this love story.
Julho de 1981. Enquanto 1 bilhão de pessoas no mundo acompanhavam o casamento do príncipe Charles com Lady Diana Spencer em Londres, na Califórnia, um casal contava os minutos para a chegada do primeiro bebê, Rachel Meghan Markle. A filha de Doria e Thomas nasceria 6 dias depois.
Her mother met her father by being a makeup artist, and her father worked on TV shows.
As americanas Lisa e Caitlin já escreviam para revistas sobre a família real. Assim que o casamento de Harry e Meghan foi anunciado, decidiram lançar um podcast.
She walks on water, her hair is perfect.
Her parents divorced when she was young, but it doesn't sound like it was a very traumatizing divorce for her.
Meghan cresceu pertinho de Hollywood, no bairro de Los Feliz, onde a mãe dela ainda mora.
We feel privileged to have a princess now.
Mesmo sendo protestante, foi nessa escola católica particular que Meghan estudou dos 11 aos 18 anos.
It seems like she just had kind of a lovely Los Angeles, very Hollywood lifestyle as a kid. Meghan grew up going to the set a lot.
Mas a Meghan, ativista, desabrochou antes da atriz.
I don't think it's right for kids to grow up thinking these things, that just mom does everything.
Ela tinha só 11 anos quando viu um anúncio de detergente que insinuava que lugar de mulher era na cozinha. Ficou indignada.
Women are fighting greasy pots and pans.
And I said, wait a minute, how could somebody say that?
O pai sugeriu que Meghan escrevesse cartas de protesto. Uma delas foi para a então primeira-dama Hillary Clinton.
So I was wondering if you would be able to change your commercial to people all over America.
And it was roughly a month later when the soap manufacturer Procter & Gamble changed the commercial for their Ivory Clear dishwashing liquid. They changed it from women all over America are fighting greasy pots and pans to people all over America. It was at that moment that I realized the magnitude of my actions. At the age of 11, I had created my small level of impact by standing up for equality. Women need a seat at the table. They need an invitation to be seated there. And in some cases, where this isn't available, well, then you know what? Then they need to create their own table.
Muito antes de namorar o príncipe Harry, Meghan já tinha conquistado espaço em várias dessas mesas. Ela é o que os americanos chamam de self-made woman. Tinha milhares de seguidores nas redes sociais e compartilhava muitas fotos de viagens e até mesmo da prática de yoga na beira da praia. Também mantinha um blog The Tig, de estilo de vida, onde cabiam dicas de livros e reflexões sobre racismo. Em 2015, em um artigo para a revista Elle, contou que enfrentou inúmeras dificuldades para ser aceita como afrodescendente. ainda menina, diante de um questionário, não sabia como se definir. Minha professora me mandou marcar o quadradinho onde estava escrito branca, porque era o que eu parecia ser. Mas eu não consegui, imaginando o nó na garganta da minha mãe se ela descobrisse depois. Meu pai me orientou. Se acontecesse de novo, eu deveria criar meu próprio quadradinho. No início da carreira, também foi difícil para Megan se encaixar. Ela não tinha a pele escura o suficiente para interpretar uma negra, nem branca o bastante para viver outros papéis. Mas Megan não queria apenas ser atriz. Engajada, ela se formou em teatro e em relações internacionais em Chicago.
She's very smart. She's very aware of stuff that's going on in the world. So it is interesting that she's been able to kind of marry her two interests, where she would act on Suits in Toronto during the year, and then in the summer she would go, for instance, to India with World Vision, or I think she was in Rwanda shortly before she met Prince Harry.
These girls are able to stay in school because they aren't walking hours a day to go and get water, and this clean water source has changed the entire community, so it's really cool to see.
Foi aqui na ONU que Megan se disse orgulhosa por ser mulher e feminista. Mas ao aceitar o pedido de casamento do príncipe Harry, ela teve que passar uma borracha no passado. Virou cidadã britânica, se converteu à religião anglicana. De um dia para o outro, mais de 2,000 fotos dela desapareceram da internet e seus perfis foram apagados das redes sociais. São as exigências do Palácio de Buckingham.
I think that the problem they have is that they don't allow people who marry into the family to speak with their own voice.
Meghan will have to lose her voice, especially on the political front. She can't go around giving out her political opinions, and I'm sure she knows that now. I mean, she could then, of course, she was a free person. She's still a free person, but she's part of an institution that is only there because of the popularity they have. They have no power.
Mas domar a noiva de Harry não deverá ser tão fácil, como se viu na própria entrevista depois do noivado.
Because I'm from the States, you don't grow up with the same understanding of the royal family, and so while I now understand very clearly there's a global interest there, I didn't know much about him, and so the only thing that I had asked her when she said she wanted to set us up was, I had one question. I said, well, is he nice?
Here is a woman who's camera ready, not camera shy, a woman who is very confident, very assertive, someone who took control of the engagement interview, for example.
Para o autor Andrew Morton, que escreveu a biografia de Diana e acaba de lançar um livro sobre Meghan, em vários aspectos, a futura mulher de Harry lembra a sogra que não conheceu.
Diana died at 36. Meghan comes into the scene at 36. And in a way, she's picked up Diana's baton, that she's both elegant, she's glamorous, and also she's a humanitarian. And so Diana would very much have approved of Meghan and seen that kind of, I don't know, that kind of the working of fate, almost.
She's certainly not as conservative as I think we're used to seeing from the royal family. She mixes up designers, she takes risks in fashions. She's been, you know, able to wear ripped jeans. I mean, talk about like someone who maybe isn't obeying traditional, you know, roles. I don't think you ever would have seen, I mean, A, most members of the royal family in jeans at all, and B, you know, them in ripped jeans. And there were people who complained about it, but at the same time, you know, there was an enormous sort of outpouring of excitement among lots of the rest of the watching world to see somebody in that role who was willing to be, you know, what seemed like a relatively normal person. And I think the palace is going to see that and appreciate that.
Toda essa ousadia e o histórico de engajamento não bastam para calar os críticos da mais nova integrante da realeza britânica.
I think it's easy to say that her giving up her career as an actress makes her a bad feminist. I mean, she can still be a feminist and have an impact, even if she's not acting.
And so she has ended her career as an actress, but now she gets to begin a new career as a humanitarian.
I do agree that it's a hard pill to swallow to think that the role of a princess should be an ideal role to advance feminist values, right? Being a princess in so many ways embodies everything that feminists have resisted, right? A woman who is promoting and conforming to social norms rather than resisting them, who's seen largely in terms of her beauty and in her relationship to her husband. Of course, the media representation of princesses tends to be about, you know, pretty, quiet, submissive people. That being said, just that Meghan Markle is in this role, we might be seeing a redefinition of that role, right?
Em uma entrevista recente, ao lado do noivo, a própria Meghan Markle respondeu essa pergunta.
I think right now in the climate that we're seeing with so many campaigns, I mean, with Me Too and Time's Up, there is no better time than to really continue to shine a light on women feeling empowered and people really helping to support them, men included in that. I mean, it makes such a tremendous difference. So, I guess we wait a couple months and then we can hit the ground running. But up until then, I'm pretty excited.
My father's very sorry not to be able to make it, so I'm going to read a message from him. It hardly seems possible that 25 years have passed since Stephen Lawrence was so cruelly taken from his family.
Não foi a primeira vez que a família real britânica se manifestou publicamente sobre o assassinato do jovem negro Stephen Lawrence. Com uma diferença em relação às ocasiões anteriores, desta vez, no mês passado, o príncipe Harry foi à cerimônia religiosa que lembrou o crime, acompanhado de uma afrodescendente, a noiva dele, a americana Meghan Markle. Harry tinha apenas 7 anos quando Stephen, um adolescente, foi morto a facadas no sul de Londres. Investigação posterior acusou a polícia de atuar com desleixo no caso e deixar escapar da justiça um grupo de jovens brancos já conhecidos como racistas. Um inquérito, anos depois, acusou a polícia da área de racista.
Stephen Lawrence case is a hugely important case for institutional racism in Britain, and it's the first time that forces Britain to accept the term that the country is institutionally racist. And the Lawrence family have done a lot to put it on the agenda, and it's really, really, really big case, high profile case.
Embora nunca tenha surgido no Reino Unido um movimento por direitos civis e raciais, na proporção do que varreu os Estados Unidos na década de 60, houve rebeliões urbanas com foco na discriminação e maus tratos a não brancos. Em levantamento recente, um quarto da população britânica admitiu ser racista. E o Instituto Nacional de Estatísticas, equivalente ao brasileiro IBGE, revela que apenas 4% da população branca se casam com pessoas não brancas nas terras da Rainha Elizabeth II. Quando a rainha foi coroada em 1953, a população de minorias étnicas representava apenas 0,1% do total.
Free men everywhere join in wishing her a long and prosperous reign.
Quase 6 décadas mais tarde, conforme o censo de 2011, não brancos somavam cerca de 15% da população.